Welcome to this special edition of the AppDevANGLE, coming to you live from Open Source Summit North America 2025. My name is Paul Nashawaty, and I'm covering the AppDev space and all things open source. I'm joined by Robert from SUSE. Robert, how you doing?
Good, good, thank you for having me.
Great to have you on today. So tell the audience a little bit about yourself.
We were talking before the cameras turned on. I was a developer for 20 years. I'm working here at SUSE. I'm the Director of Technical and Community Marketing, so I focus on the outreach of not just our products, but our communities as well.
Absolutely. It's great to have you here because we were talking about the importance of the developers and the importance of how the products come to market is really what the developers are doing, and their time is very important as well.
I make the joke every once in a while is engineers, they use code to create business problems, where developers use code to solve business problems, and making them more efficient, being the voice for them. That's why I'm happy to be here, and I'm happy that you're doing what you're doing, because you are a voice for those developers who don't have a voice in normal organizations.
Yeah, try to be. That's what we're doing here. So, hey, so let's talk a little bit about SUSE and what's happening here at OSS, right? So choice happens, right? Choice happens in the open source community, but choice also happens at SUSE. That's your tagline.
It is. Choice happens is, it's not, I don't even want to call it a tagline. It's kind of something we live by. And
right.
So we give, customers, we give community members choice and to adopt and use what they need to solve their problems. So it's kind of built into what we do. We're a very community first company. Our CEO will tell you that. It's community first, and he loves to hear about what they're doing in the community and the choices that they're making, because that does influence the choices that we make, through on what we're doing at SUSE.
I really love the messaging that SUSE has, right? Because I mean, it really is, you're spot on. You're about your community, mm-hmm. You're about your following. Your followers love you. They really kind of, adopt what you're doing and kind of feel it's really working. So it's great. And let's jump into the first kind of part of this discussion when we talk about AI workloads, right?
Okay.
The run and deploy AI workloads anywhere, that's a theme that you have. That's I'll call it a go-to-market that you have,
yep.
Right? It's definitely important when we start talking about AI workloads across the entire ecosystem. Can you expand a little bit more about why that's important?
Everyone's came out with an AI product, and everyone's trying to go to market with a unique one. And what we're trying to solve is, how do we give you the ability to choose where you run your AI workloads and do it securely with the tools that you need? A secure version of Ollama, a secure version of what? And so that's where we want our community and our customers to know this: we don't care where you run it, right? If you want to run it on-prem, great. If you want to run it in the cloud, great. But we want you to do it securely, and we want you to have the choice to pull what you need to run those AI workloads.
You know what's interesting is we just came out of our AppDev Summit, right? Mm-hmm. Which is we ran a whole set of new research, great research around day zero, day one, day two, and DevSecOps. So really excited about that. But one of the things we found is when we started to build these AI workloads, what we found is that a lot of organizations are bursting to, say, the cloud mm-hmm. to build these workloads. Well, we found that 46% of organizations are building their new AI workloads in the cloud. And we have found that 11% are doing their development of their AI workloads on-prem, mm-hmm. right? But we extrapolated that out and we asked the audience, where are you going in the next 2 years, right? And we found that in the next 2 years, 33% of those organizations are saying that they're using their workloads or building their workloads on-prem. So the deploy anywhere model really is resonating with organizations. We see almost a pullback from the public cloud, but we also see that location is almost doesn't matter, so to speak, because the workload deployments really matter. What are your thoughts on that?
So when it comes to running where you need to run, one of the things that we want to kind of help with our community and with our customers is they need to choose where they need to run. And with AI, there's a lot of FUD, there's a lot of concern about the data, right? Is the hyperscalers stealing my data? Are they using it in a way, there's fear around it. And so I see that comeback, and it gives them the option to choose, but they're coming back because they don't know. And I think when they understand it, they're going to look back at their hyperscalers, and they're going to make business decisions around, hey, it really needs to run in this hyperscaler in this region because of government regulations or whatever. I think we're going to have that. And giving them the choice to go, hey, it's the same here as it is in on-prem, it's very easy for the knowledge that the individuals have within an organization to transfer it one to another.
And that helps with skill gap, too.
Yeah.
Right? Because you don't have to learn different platforms.
No,
right?
No.
But that kind of goes into my next kind of thought here, which is talking about the developer workflows and the frictionless, or trying to make it more frictionless, right? When we think about Kubernetes-based deployments and to reduce friction across the developer workflows, how is SUSE helping with this? Because this is a common problem we're seeing in the industry.
Yeah, we've solved it before with Cloud Foundry, and we were solving it again with Kubernetes, right? And so what we've done is, in the community, we've taken best practices around our developer workflows, and we're taking that, we're listening to the what their community's doing, we're seeing what our customers are doing, and we're republishing it back, saying, hey, here's some best practices when it comes to those workflows. From automation, from security, we're saying, hey, these are some of the best practices you need to have. And then to make life easier, we're offering products such as our application collection to, you don't have to go and find a secure version of PostgreSQL. You don't have to worry about updating it. We have that taken care of. Worry about solving a business problem, like I mentioned earlier, less about the security, because let us take care of that for you.
Well, I like that comment, because we are solving business problems. AI is really not so much about the tech stack, as much as that enables it to make it work, of course, but it is a business problem.
Yeah.
And that's where I think it's a challenge. But I want to double click on security and compliance, because that's an area that I think is top of mind for a lot of organizations when it comes to open source, right?
Correct.
And we think of open source ecosystem, security and compliance, it's like, okay, in my mind, knowing about open source, and especially being at an event like this, open source really hardens solutions that are out there, because there's more people banging on it, right,
sure,
making it work. But a lot of organizations are like, well, if it's open, how much more secure is it?
Yeah, and a lot of organizations they rely on open source, but they can't contribute back to at the level that they want to. And right, when it comes to security, they can't contribute back, hey, I found something. They need to rely on that. And what we do at SUSE is, security and compliance is what we do every day. And it is like so nonchalant, it's like opening the refrigerator for us. We don't think about it in regards of, oh my God, we need to start doing it, because we have always done it. And
yeah,
it's always what we do. And it's what our customers and our community expects of us. From our certifications for SLES, even to our base container instance with SLE BCI, it's top of mind for what we do. And we want people to use these products because we want them to be secure for that, and not have to worry about, is it getting scanned, is it, we have your back, we're doing that, we're helping you do that.
Well, yeah, and I also think your new Vector acquisition a few years ago was really helped, really excelled or boosted the SUSE play into security and compliance. Talk a little bit to me about, and I kind of understand, but I'm thinking more about the hybrid environment. Like, why is, like, it does it, is it different when it comes to security on hybrid environments, or is it the same? How do you see that?
There's things that cross over, but then there's other considerations from what you have to worry about in your data center versus what you have to worry about in the cloud, right? Even something as silly as who can have access to your data center is something you don't worry about in AWS, because it's physical access. But there's some considerations. In a hybrid environment, we try to make the hybrid experience where what you're doing in the cloud and what you're doing on-prem is unified as possible, but there's going to be some considerations between the hyperscalers, right? They're not one for one. There's a lot of cross features, but there's things that they do differently that we need to accommodate for, and there's things that customers and community members really need to accommodate for, right?
Like,
you don't want that AWS bill. We joke about it all the time, but if you leave something open, you're
of course.
It's going to happen.
Yeah, it is going to happen.
I'm not saying it happened to me, but it might have. I'm sorry.
No, of course not. Of course not, never. But let's kind of also talk a little bit more about security. When we talk about the community, right?
Mm-hmm.
We talk about how SUSE is actively involved in the community. It is a very strong community. The open innovation and supply chain, software supply chain security that we're seeing here at OSS is really kind of, really prevalent. We see that organizations are concerned about this, and not just with things like executive orders here in the US, but also things that are upcoming, like the EU CRA, for example, that's
Correct.
Coming. So there's a lot of areas where we want to be aware of it as developers, understand that there's security elements. I guess the question I have is, what is SUSE doing to help drive trusted software security pipelines?
So we're doing on a few things. On our container side, on our Linux side, we have our open build service. We're doing a lot of things. We know where the code's coming from. We're building it, we're packaging it up. It's the same service that we use externally for the community to use. It's pretty much the same. OBS is the same tools that we use to build our SLES operating system. So we know where the code comes from. On the cloud native side, our application collection is doing just that. We are pulling these sources, we're building them, we're doing that, and it's driving innovation on our side, but it's also driving it for the community as well. We also get back with our base container images I mentioned earlier. They're hardened, they're secure. We deploy our code on it, and we ship that, and we want our community members to do the same thing, and to explain the reason why we want the community. Because once a community adopts something, then we know that organizations are more, the skill gap's not there, right? Because there's not a gap. We understand we're going to do it. They're already doing it. We want them to be doing it on, you know, as community members.
Yeah, absolutely. And then, I think that when we talk about community-driven innovation, I do want to talk about this, because this is an important topic here. Not that all of this isn't important, but I think that we look at market trends, right? And we see what's happening in the European market, for example, but also in APAC as well. The intersection between sovereignty, ecosystem collaboration, and the community, that's a strategic direction for SUSE, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes, that is correct. And we don't see it as something that's at a country, company, or organizational level. It's a community issue as well. You know, the sovereignty is, as an individual, you should know where your code comes from. You should be able to pull it, use it, run it, and have the choice to do that. And so we're taking that approach, and it starts with the community, and it works all the way through our customers, through organizations, through government entities as well. It's that same approach that we think. And we look at it as not just a country issue, or European versus American issue, but it's an individual, and it's a community issue, and we need to, as a community, to acknowledge it, and we're championing that right now.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, software development is a global thing. It's not based on specific regions, but we do have regional restrictions and codes that we have to follow, and compliance and regulations. Those are things that definitely should be front of mind for developers, right?
And as a developer, you should know that you're going to, any new developer out there, the first thing they're going to learn is they're working with developers from around the world.
Even
if you're not in open source, you might be working with somebody from India or the Czech Republic. It's just natural, and there's rules and regulations that we have to kind of mitigate as we're going forward.
Absolutely. Well, how about leaving the audience with some closing thoughts? What are your thoughts here?
This is a great event. First of all, thank you. I said earlier that I'm happy that you're championing the voice of the voiceless in with the app developer side of things. So this is really exciting for me because I'm 20 years as a developer. You are our unsung hero. Championing those causes, so thank you very much for that. And we'll see you, I think, next at KubeCon?
KubeCon, definitely be at KubeCon, for sure.
All right.
Well, thank you, Robert. Thank you for your insights. I really want to thank you for being here today. I want to thank the audience for all of you that are tuning in. We appreciate you being part of the AppDev community. That wraps up this episode for today, but we'll be back next Wednesday with another conversation driving to tools, tech trends, and tech talent, shaping the future of application development. Whether you're deploying at the edge, building with AI, or modernizing your cloud stack, we've got you covered. Be sure to follow us on social. If you have any thoughts, questions, or just want to connect, you can always reach me at paulnashawaty@siliconangle.com. Until next time, stay curious and stay building.